Okay, the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 6299 in the name of Pam Gosell on recognising the International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call Pam Gosell to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Ms Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is an honour to bring forward today's debate to mark the International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women and Girls, which will take place this Friday on November the 25th, which is followed by the 16 days of activism. This year's theme is Unite Activism to End Violence Against Women and Girls. Thanks to our dedicated police force and our endlessly dedicated third sector organisations, women in Scotland have a voice. The drive to make the world a safer place for women and girls gains more momentum every year, and this year is no different. As always, there remains a hard battle to be won, whether that's against anti-feminist movements, human traffickers, or lone abusers. But women will not back down. Just look at the bravery and resilience of the Iranian women who are protesting following the suspicious death of Mahsa Amini. They are fighting for their freedom, and today we all stand in solidarity with them. The UK is a leader in women's rights, and we cannot afford to go backwards, and we cannot grow complacent.
Would the member take an intervention?
Yes.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Is the member aware of comments reported today from a leading United Nations official who warns that the SNP's gender self-ID law risks endangering women and calls for it to be put on hold?
Pam Gosell.
I thank the member for her intervention, as this is a very serious point. It is deeply concerning that the United Nations experts on violence against women has expressed her concerns over legislation passing through this chamber right now. After months, if not years, of the SNP telling women that their concerns over the GRR bill were imaginary, the United Nations has confirmed that it could, and I quote, potentially open the door for violent males to abuse the process of acquiring a gender certificate, and that it does present risk to the safety of women. I would like to take this opportunity in this debate about eliminating violence against women to urge the SNP, if they won't listen to the concerns of women, campaigners and even their own members, to listen to the United Nations experts and not bring in any law which might harm the rights or safety of women. As I say, we cannot afford to go backwards. The recorded crime in Scotland statistics for 2021 to 2022 provide a bleak snapshot of the dangers facing women and girls in Scotland. For example, sexual crimes by 15% have soared on the year before, which is the equivalent of 96% rise since 2012. And worse yet, even less of these sexual crimes have been solved. I acknowledge the efforts that have been made to develop policy to tackle violence against women and girls. However, this is quite clearly not going far enough. Women shouldn't have to walk home with their keys rammed between their knuckles in case they come across an assailant, but we do. Women shouldn't have to walk the long way home to avoid quiet areas and blind spots, but we do. Women shouldn't have to watch for shadows cast on paths as they walk home, but we do. And until we don't, we cannot stop looking for new ways to tackle violence against women and girls. Which brings me on to my next area of focus. That often takes place a lot closer to home, domestic abuse. Last year, domestic abuse statistics were shocking. In 2020 to 2021, there was more than 65,000 incidents of domestic abuse recorded by Police Scotland. And even more tragic is that around of these, half of these were committed by re-offenders. Throughout the year, I have engaged with countless domestic abuse organisations and individuals. one of whom said to me, they cannot understand how an abuser is able to ruin so many lives and get off so lightly for their crimes. And this is exactly why I brought forward my proposals for the Domestic Abuse Prevention Scotland Bill. If one thing is clear, it's that a register must be created to stop perpetrators moving from area to area and from victim to victim. We need to do more to ensure rehabilitation is no longer a postcode lottery. We must improve the data we collect on domestic abuse to understand the support and services required in different communities, because one size does not fit all. This is particularly the case for BAME and disabled individuals. And finally, Presiding Officer, education. Children at a young age must be taught that domestic abuse is wrong. They need to know what an unhealthy relationship looks like and to be aware of the support services available to them. I would like to take this opportunity to thank every organisation, every individual who has taken their time to complete my consultation, which is closed now. As I have outlined today, there is a clear-cut case for doing more. And I hope that you all will give my proposed bill due consideration. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I would like to end my contribution, firstly, by recognising the endless activism of the third sector who are there to fight the corner of victims. Secondly, by uniting together in the knowledge that our efforts will make a difference to the lives of women and girls around the world. And last but not least, we must all commit today to do more, to be their voices. We cannot give up. We must eradicate violence against women and girls.
Thank you, Ms Gosell. It will not surprise the Chamber to learn there's an awful lot of interest in this evening's debate. I'd be grateful, therefore, if members could stick broadly to their time allocations. With that, we move to the open debate. I call firstly Michelle Thompson, to be followed by Pauline McNeill for around 4 minutes. Ms Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to Pam Gosell for this debate in recognising the importance of the International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women. Even though I've had my own challenging experiences in the past, I'm very sensitive to the fact that many women across the world face much more deadly threats and repression than anyone in our country of Scotland will have experienced. I therefore want to dedicate my speech to the courageous women and girls of Iran. They display a quite remarkable heroism standing against repression and brutality. Their cause is admirably summed up in their cry, Zan Zendegi Azadi, woman, life, freedom. Throughout history, Iranian women have participated in national protests. Today, they're leading the way, confronting the Iranian regime's abusive and regressive treatment of women and girls. Regrettably, the Iranian government is responding with lethal force. The brutal killing of 22-year-old Mahsa Amini by Iran's so-called morality police has sparked nationwide protests. In violent crackdowns, the regime is trying to crush calls for the human rights of women to be recognised. Already, over 100 civilians, including at least 23 children, have been killed with impunity since the 19th of September 2022. It seems unimaginable that scores of women and children are being brutally murdered by cowardly men to protect the immorality of a brutal regime. It's not only the evil of the killings that concern me, though. Countless numbers are being thrown into prison to face torture. As Sonia Angelica Diane has recently written, and I quote, "In Iran, men and women are equal, only in torture." Torture is a standard method of the regime. In terms of direct physical torture, it includes whippings, being hung by the hands for lengthy periods, or being forced to sit for many hours with hands tied together behind the back. As part of systematic psychological torture, techniques include total isolation for weeks or even months, enforced sleep deprivation, threats of sexual violence, and threats of violence towards our family. And these acts are happening as we speak. UN Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women, Professor Rashida Manju revealed in his report of October 2013 that torture in Iranian prisons included men raping virgins prior to execution. That women and young girls are therefore brave enough in such a society to throw off their headscarves and confront the violence of state police are extraordinary acts of bravery. Courage is indeed calling to courage in Iran. We need as many international voices as possible to put pressure on the Iranian regime to end all torture. And I join my voice with that of Pam Gozal. And I hope the members participating in this debate also feel able to add their own voices. So in this International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women, let us all join the Iranian rallying cry for women, for life, for freedom. Zan Zendegi Azadi, indeed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Thompson. I call Pauline McNeill to be followed by Russell Finlay. Again, around 4 minutes.
Thank you, and thank you to Pam Gozal for nominating this important debate for her members' business this evening. I must apologise to you, Pam, and to other speakers. I didn't realise we'd gone so late tonight, so unfortunately I can't remain for the whole debate, but I really wanted to speak in it because on November 25th, we observe the International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women. And on this day, we are reminded of all the women and girls who are victims of male violence. And we are reminded of the need to eradicate all forms of violence against women and girls as a matter of urgency. On Friday, Scottish Labour will launch our own consultation on changing the future of women and girls, simply because we want to be part of the conversation about how we can change this for all time. Like other speakers, I too applaud the bravery of Iranian women marching in the streets. But I would add that there are many other women in other countries also being brave. In Saudi Arabia, for example, and in Afghanistan, in these regimes speaking out, in many other countries across the world where girls are not given an education, where they are treated appallingly, is an extension of widespread global discrimination against women and girls. Gender-based violence is one of the most systematic, socially tolerated human rights violations of our time, and global estimates published by the World Health Organization in 2021 indicate that 1 in 3 women worldwide will experience physical or sexual violence in their lifetime. And at least 1 in 5 women in Scotland will experience domestic abuse too. An average of 6 rapes are reported every day. And shockingly, I'm sure we've debated this before, the figure is low as 7% of reported rapes and attempted rapes make it to court in Scotland in 2021. Figures released by the Scottish Government yesterday revealed that reported sexual crimes were 6% higher on the year ending September. And what you see here, worryingly, is that the trend, unfortunately, is rising. But the question we must answer is, how are we going to tackle the root cause of this? And the root cause of this will be the same in Scotland as it is in the rest of the world. I know that the ministers share this view. I know we probably all share this view, but it's a question we need to continue to return to. The epidemic of misogyny and inequality across our society. And research has shown that socially constructed gender norms that socialise boys and men to value hierarchy, aggression, power, respect and emotional suppression may be a primary root cause of violence against women. In these debates, you always find that you're literally on your last minute and you feel you haven't really said anything at all. So I really have to just say in conclusion in this debate, for me, the most important thing, I could go through more statistics, which are shocking. The most important thing is that this Parliament must continue to do the work in identifying the root causes. We know that boys of a certain age, who we've seen this time and time again, are mimicking the behaviour of other males. And in a sense, we've got to break that cycle. We've got to break the cycle of young girls who arguably are more harassed now than they were in my generation. Because figures show that they're harassed going to school, and the advent of social media means that many of them are under pressure to give nude photographs of themselves as part of a normalised way of growing up. This should not be normal. This is not acceptable behaviour in schools. And I conclude by saying, I know that Christine McKelvey and Shona Robson We'll see probably tonight about the work of Equally Safe, and I think that I really do support this programme. I'd like to see extended in every school. If I could make one request, I'd like to see this in action, if I may. We must work together to eradicate violence against women and girls. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms McNeill. I now call Russell Finlay to be followed by Beatrice Wishart for around 4 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy President Officer. Let me also begin by thanking my colleague Pam Gosso for bringing forward this important debate. And I also absolutely associate myself and my party with the comments from Michelle Thompson about the heroism and tragedy taking place in Iran. And indeed, as Pauline McNeill says, the bravery of women fighting similar battles in so many other countries around the world. Deputy Presiding Officer, Pam's campaigning work on domestic abuse and violence is a shining example of the good this Parliament can do. Her bill to create a domestic abuse register should be commended and supported by MSPs across the chamber. It's a strong, well-intentioned and well-considered proposal. It would introduce a system along the same lines as the Sex Offenders Register. Those who commit violence within the home would be added to the database by a sheriff. Police officers would then have access to this information about those who pose such a risk. Now, Police Scotland already operate such a scheme. It's called the Disclosure Scheme for Domestic Abuse Scotland. This gives people the right to ask about the background of their partner, but Pam's register, which is still being shaped, may go even further, and I hope it does. I strongly believe that transparency should be central to our justice system. Secrecy and closed doors are a feature of so many of the scandals we've seen in which victims have been let down. There should be no hiding place for those who commit domestic violence and abuse. Pam has already highlighted the scandal that one in three
Mr.
women...
Mr Finlay, I know it's a members' debate and it's slightly more informal, but if I could encourage you to use full names rather than just first names. Thank
apologies.
You.
Apologies. I didn't realise that was the form. Pam Gosol has already highlighted the scandal that one in three women suffer violence, but it's a global problem. And as my colleague said, let's not lose sight of the fact that Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom are at the forefront of women's rights. And this is true today as it has been historically. However, it is a problem we can do more to tackle. Women in Scotland still face discrimination and misogyny, abuse and violence every day. It seems that every week I speak with women who have been through the horrors of sexual assault or rape, women who have been stalked, preyed on, or had their drinks spiked, women who have had their lives trashed by abusers with revenge porn, emotional abuse, or everyday low-level harassment. Just this afternoon, I met with the Chief Constable of British Transport Police, who told me that an estimated 75% of sexual offences on our railways pass unreported. Many women share a belief that Scotland's justice system does not always live up to the values that it likes to espouse, and I agree. Right now, our justice system remains stacked against victims. The Parliament could act more decisively to tackle violence against women. We could increase sentences for violent and sexual crimes. We could make sure those who commit unspeakable acts serve their full sentences. We could end automatic early release. We could increase pitifully low rates of conviction for sex assaults and rapes. We could make the justice system more understanding and compassionate. We could stop sex offenders changing their names and indeed their gender. We could ensure courts deliver justice much more quickly. We could stop men from exploiting the courts to prolong their abuse. And we could pass Pam Gosol's Domestic Abuse Register Bill. If anyone in this Parliament of any party wants to progress any of these policies to end violence against women, this bill is a good place to start. And in closing, Deputy Presiding Officer, I hope that we will step up and use our powers to end violence against women. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Finlay. And I call Beatrice Wishart to be followed by Carol Mochan. Again, around 4 minutes, Ms Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak today to recognise the International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women. And thank you to Pam Gosol for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. Gender-based violence refers to harmful acts directed at an individual or individuals based on their gender. It is rooted in gender inequality, abuse of power, and harmful norms. Violence against women is any act of gender-based violence that results in or is likely to result in physical, sexual or mental harm or suffering to women and girls. These definitions demonstrate that violence against women occurs both privately within families and communities and publicly perpetrated or condoned by the state. Since the pandemic began, 45% of women report that they or a woman they know has experienced a form of violence. Lockdowns, increased isolation, and economic uncertainty exposed women and girls to increased rates of domestic violence and child marriage. Violence against women remains one of the most pervasive human rights violations across the globe. Impunity, stigma, and shame result in underreporting and failures to address problems. Here in Scotland, the death of Adrian McCartney, as reported in the Sunday Post last week, shows the horrific consequences of structural failings to address violence against women. It's heartbreaking to read the litany of failures from public authorities who were supposed to protect her. And I'm sure members here tonight would join me in extending deepest sympathy to Adrian's family and friends. Action is needed. We need recognition that women suffer directly and indirectly from male violence and biased patriarchal systems. Presiding Officer, I turn now to highlight the situation faced by women and girls in Afghanistan, now over a year since the Taliban returned to power. Women and girls in Afghanistan are being systemically excluded from public life. Human rights violations against women and girls are increasing. Girls no longer allowed to school past sixth grade, women barred from most jobs and effectively eliminated from political participation, women facing increased restrictions on their movements and bodies. Removing education from girls violates their right to education and creates lifelong adverse consequences. Maniza, a teacher, said to UN Women, "I ask the international community to listen to Afghan women. I say we are hearing you, Maniza." From a counsellor who helps women heal from trauma and enrol in literacy and vocational training, to a human rights defender who has stayed in Afghanistan to help women, Afghan women continue to unite, forming new civil society groups, reopening businesses, all under constant threat of violence. I turn now to Iran, where a woman-led protest movement demanding political freedom is persisting, as Michelle Thompson highlighted. In addition to laws on women's clothing, the government ratified a law which criminalises abortion and restricts family planning. Catalysed by the death in custody of Mahsa Amini, women-led protesters are pushing back against increasing government control over women's lives. When we spoke in this chamber for International Women's Day in March, our thoughts were of the women of Ukraine. 9 months on, impacts of war continue to disproportionately affect women and girls. A UN report highlights school-age girls are at high risk of being forced out of school and into marriage. Women faced food insecurity, increased care responsibilities, and heightened risk of sexual violence. Presiding Officer, across the world, civil society organisations, women's networks, and human rights defenders are working tirelessly to combat violence against women. Efforts to end violence against women must be inclusive and intersectional, paying attention to the multiple discriminations faced by many women, including women with disabilities and LGBT plus women. So together, let's unite in activism to end violence against women and girls. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Wishart. I now call Carol Mochan to be followed by Maggie Chapman again around 4 minutes. Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I start by thanking Pam Gozo for bringing this debate to the Chamber tonight? One of my first speeches last year was, in fact, the debate on eliminating violence against women. And in that speech, I remember reflecting on the fact that whilst work across the globe on this issue is to be commended and essential, it must make us in this chamber think. We have a responsibility, we, the elected members in this Parliament, we have a responsibility to work hard, to make decisions, to make action happen, to ensure we do have the same, to make sure that we don't have the same remarks to make in years to come. And so I am here speaking again to ensure we in the Scottish Parliament do all that we can to raise awareness, change and implement suitable laws and amplify the voices of women and girls. The theme this year is Unite, coming together to end gender-based violence. And so again, I thank Pam Gozo for allowing us here in this chamber to do just that. Deputy Presiding Officer, as the motion says, violence against women and girls continues to be one of the most pervasive human rights violations worldwide. The statistics are damning. It affects more than an estimated 1 in 3 women, and that is estimated that on average a woman or girl is killed by someone in their own family every 11 minutes across the globe. Every 11 minutes across the globe. Since the outbreak of COVID-19, emerging data and reports from those on the front line have shown that all types of violence against women and girls, particularly domestic violence, as we've heard, has intensified. Each woman who is a victim of violence must be treated equally and fairly by an establishment that understands, or at least seeks to begin to understand, why they have gone through this. We need a global collective effort to stop it, and we need to understand that everyone has a role to play. That begins with accepting this is a serious problem across the globe, and we do not have this under control. It means more honesty from governments. It means direct engagement with grassroots organisations, health and recovery charities, and global institutions. It means prevention strategies focused on early education, respectful relationships and working with men and boys, especially through and in the media, in the sports industry, in the world of work, and as my colleague Pauline mentioned, becoming much more to the front as the social media aspect. We must tackle this here in Scotland and right across the globe. As parliamentarians must push to ensure women's representation at all levels in politics, in economic development, in governance and in planning. The list is endless, but until women and girls have full and equal representation, until that is addressed, it is unlikely we will change these dreadful statistics. Deputy Presiding Officer, there is so much to be done, but I will close by thanking my colleagues here today who have raised these really important issues about violence against women and girls from right across the globe. And I know that we can unite in this Parliament to end this outrageous blight on global society and make sure we tackle violence against women and girls. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mochan. And I call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Marie McNair. Again, around 4 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to Pam Gosol for securing this debate and to have the opportunity to speak on this topic 2 days before the International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women and the 16 Days of Activism. I'd like also to thank all those organisations and agencies who work day in and day out to support survivors, and I refer colleagues to my register of interests. The existence of this official day is perhaps a sign of progress, that the reality of violence against women and girls is being recognised by institutions and decision makers. But how much of the picture are we really seeing? What image arises when we think of gender-based violence? Is the woman cis and straight, with all her papers in order, dressed and behaving appropriately? And her attacker? Is he a stranger to her, a man without authority, not in uniform, visibly unreliable, criminal? Monstrous. We know that not all violence against women follows this pattern, and yet the more it deviates from this image, the less sure we are of how wrong it is. The UN webpage for the day recognises this, identifying those women particularly likely to be attacked, not the meekly respectable, but the outsiders, including, and I quote, women who identify as lesbian, bisexual, transgender, intersex, migrants, and refugees. It is no coincidence that these identities are those who suffer societal prejudice and oppression. For the problem of violence against women is not one of isolated incidents perpetrated by individual men of intrinsic evil. They are symptoms of a deeper disease, a disease not just of misogyny, but of homophobia, transphobia, xenophobia, and a visceral fear of difference and of sharing privilege and status. Worse than that, those incidents are in reality a harvest, the expected outcome of the seeds that are planted, watered and fed, not only by men, not only by tabloid presses, but not only by populist demagogues, not only in countries we think of as regressive or repressive. The UN also recognises that violence against women is not only perpetrated by strangers. We know that it comes from intimate partners, from families, and from lawfully constituted authorities. And those women who are more likely to experience violence, generally, including trans women, are also more likely to be survivors, or tragically, not survivors, of these embedded, disguised, and often hidden attacks. Trans women are as likely as cis women to be attacked in any context because they are women, but they are also highly likely, as are trans men and non-binary people, to be attacked because they are perceived as trans or as gender non-conforming. Domestic abuse in all its forms, including coercive control, is experienced by many trans women, with transphobia yet another weapon in the abuser's armoury. And trans women are not only more likely to be in precarious financial situations, unemployed or underemployed, and in legal limbo regarding their gender status, but also to face huge barriers in accessing support and shelter, whether from medical, law enforcement, or third sector agencies. Those vulnerabilities, those precarities, and those barriers are, make no mistake, the direct result of false and misleading narratives which are still being constructed and disseminated by mainstream media and by elected politicians. Those narratives don't have to be openly transphobic to be deeply damaging to all trans and non-binary people, and to many cis women too, who do not conform to gatekeepers' ideas of what a woman should look and sound like. While lip service is paid to the idea of a genuine trans person, the underlying message is that trans women are intrinsically unsafe and untrustworthy. There is indeed a danger, but it is one existing for, not created by, our trans sisters. The theme of this year's UN Day and the 16 days of action which follow it is unite. In closing, Presiding Officer, my most heartfelt hope during these weeks of our parliamentary business is that we can indeed unite in distinguishing reality from rhetoric and in recognising and combating both particular and structural forms of violence. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Chapman. Before proceeding, as I said earlier, there's a lot of interest in this debate, and given the number of members who still want to participate, I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes, and I invite Pam Gosel to move such a motion.
Moved, Deputy Presiding Officer.
The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? That is agreed. And with that, I call Marie McNair to be followed by Martin Whitfield for around 4 minutes. Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A pleasure to follow the speech by Maggie Chapman. I'm pleased to speak in this debate to recognise International Day of the Elimination of Violence Against Women on the 25th of November and the 16 days of activism that follows. The United Nations rightly declare that violence against women and girls is one of the most widespread, persistent and devastating human rights violations in our world today, and it remains largely unreported due to the impunity, silence, stigma and shame surrounding it. This year the theme of 2022 is Unite, Activism to End Violence Against Women and Girls. The theme is clear that supporting and investing in strong, autonomous women's rights organisations and feminist movements is key to ending violence against women and girls. In preparation of my contribution and in recognition of the main theme, I took time to speak to one of the women's aid groups in my constituency. Clybank Women's Aid have been providing emotional and practical support and refuge for women and children and young people subjected to domestic abuse for 41 years. I asked them what they wanted Parliament to know. They are clear that for them, dedicated days of action extend beyond 16 days of the year. For women, children and young people experiencing abuse, they need more than 16 days of action. They live with male violence 365 days of the year, some of which will be living with the lifelong implications with several others murdered. The reality for women, children and young people remains greatly unchallenged, unchanged, with barriers limiting options for women. Clybank Women's Aid point out strongly that we need to make sure enough refuge spaces are available for women. This is vital when fleeing domestic abuse and they mean women have no option but to stay. The group are keen that we recognise that the current cost of living crisis will impact on a woman's ability to flee. Where women are more economically deprived, the less financial choices they have available to them. Women deserve specialist women's aid services which are underpinned by feminist analyses of domestic abuse, and the cost of living crisis may impact upon this. To support this, they call for the Scottish Government to guarantee ring-fenced funding for Women's Aid Network in Scotland. During my 19 years as a councillor, I formed a good relationship with Clydebank Women's Aid. They're a strong part of a strong partnership and policy platform that aims to support women and change societal attitudes. As part of this approach, West Dunbartonshire Council became the first social landlord in Scotland to introduce a zero-tolerance policy on domestic abuse within its properties. The Council introduced measures which ensure victims have immediate access to practical help and specialist legal assistance and support following any incident of domestic abuse. We know that domestic abuse can have a devastating and long-term impact on a woman's life, and it can result in homelessness, isolation, loss of earnings, physical and mental health problems, injuries and even death. Living with domestic abuse can seriously affect a child's emotional and psychological well-being and undermine the relationship with their mother and have other negative consequences. Research by UN Women show that 45% of women reported that they or a woman they know experienced a form of violence against women and girls. 7 in 10 women say they think that verbal or physical abuse by a partner has become more common. These statistics are unacceptable. There are a number of welcome initiatives in place that are making a difference, and also the important legislative changes made by the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018. These are all important to the aim of eliminating violence against women and girls. But as the Unite campaign points out, it is uniting with groups like Clydebank Women's Aid that will be key to the success of this, and silences of women through violence must end. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms McNair. I now call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Sharon Dowie for around 4 minutes. Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I first, like others, extend my thanks to Pam Gosell for bringing this motion before the Chamber tonight. A very powerful motion, and talking of some of the most horrendous activities that happen around the world. And I was immediately caught by the statistic that 1 in 3 women have experienced violence. And as the UN have pointed out, it is probably the most pervasive of human rights violations that occur around the world. And that 1 in 3 struck me because of debates that I've had the privilege to listen to in the past, because of course the 25th of November is the anniversary of the murder of Petrina Minerva and Maria Theresa, the Mirabel sisters, in the Dominican Republic. Three sisters who stood up against a dictatorship, who stood up against the violence that was being expressed towards and specifically at women. And three women who paid the ultimate price in their murder. But then the horror of the then dictator and henchman trying to cover it up to make it look like an accident. And I recall the powerful words of Minerva, who said, "If they kill me, I'll reach my arms out from the tomb and I'll be stronger." And she was stronger, and women are stronger, both for this date, but also because of the experiences that they have lived through. I want to pick up on Pam Gosell's contribution about the role of education, because I am extremely concerned that within our higher education institutions in particular, we are failing the women who are victims of sexual violence and gender-based violence, so accurately described by Beatrice Wishart earlier. And we must do more to prevent sexual assault in all forms, and we must support the victims. In January, the Scottish Government said that universities should be places where students study free from sexual harassment and gender-based violence, and we do need to see more action on this. But because the 16 days that are coming up talks about work that can be done, I would like to highlight Harriet Watt's participation in the White Ribbon campaign, Edinburgh Napier staff who are given pocket-sized cards that can be handed out with information on how to respond to a disclosure of gender-based violence, equipping staff and empowering students to come forward with the knowledge they need. The work of the Consent Collective and the University of Edinburgh about how the university community there can start talking about consent, talking about sex, gender, sexual harassment and relationships, using language that is supportive and in a supportive environment. And also make mention of the compulsory orientation module at the University of St Andrews that requires students to learn about consent, to learn about sexual assault before matriculating. A very important step, given the childhood experiences that we've heard of today, of the challenges that young children feel and the challenge they have to their own mental health when they see sexual violence around them. But I also must pay particular tribute to the work of the Emily Test, the project born out of a tragedy that's doing incredible work to tackle gender-based violence in education, and the Gender-Based Violence Charter for colleges and universities. We need our educational establishments to be safe for everyone. And in order to do that, we need to make it safe for our women and girls, because at the minute it is not. And we've heard sufficient evidence in this debate alone to say more must be done. I would like to finish harking back to the quote, "To reach beyond the grave to become stronger," with a quote from Councillor Colin McGinn from East Lothian. A quote that is recent, a quote that speaks to where I think every single man should be, and a quote that I would hope we can take forward over the next 16 days from the start. It is appalling that in our modern and enlightened times, violence against women and girls remains a reality for so many. It is not a remote issue. It is not something that happens elsewhere to other people that you don't know. It is happening right here in East Lothian communities right now. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Whitfield. I now call Sharon Dowie to be followed by Katie Clark for around 4 minutes, Ms. Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank my colleague, Pam Goswell, for securing this important debate. I'm dealing with a case involving a man who assaulted multiple partners and traumatised his own children, so much so that he was given a permanent no-contact order. He was also given community service, probation and counselling, no jail time, and nothing that had any impact on his behaviour. He breached his probation by entering into a relationship with my constituent, becoming a step-parent to her children. It didn't take long before his campaign of abuse escalated and he began throwing the children along hallways, grabbing them by their throat or hair and dragging them upstairs by their ears. He received a non-harassment order and was told not to contact the mother or children. He ignored this, getting accomplices to stalk her, break windows in the family home, and they had to flee to a safe house. But although little to nothing happened to the abuser, the trauma continues for the family. The experiences they have suffered have changed them. The family spoke about how this person's actions affected their children. To them, it's clear that the domestic violence their children endured severely traumatised them. The situation has not improved. In her words, her son has changed beyond recognition, going from a youngster who gave everyone hugs, had a great sense of humour and looked out for his younger sister, to one who recently attacked and seriously hurt his younger brother. The family talked about burying their heads in their hands and crying over what has been taken from them by a serial abuser, an abuser who has no remorse and mocks Scotland's justice system while going about his daily business. Regrettably, this family is just one of many in Scotland who are affected by domestic abuse on a daily basis. I'm therefore pleased to see my colleague Pam Goswell's proposal for a domestic abuse register bill. Violence against women and girls has no place in our society. Ultimately, we want to create a society that eliminates violence against women and girls. It is also our responsibility to establish a system that effectively deters and punishes potential abusers and one that unconditionally supports victims. And to finish, Presiding Officer, I'd like to touch on the need to support victims of domestic violence. Reem Al-Salem, the United Nations Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women and Girls, has written a letter on the GRR Bill and she has raised a number of concerns. For persons identifying as women, the certificate would create a legal presumption that they have the right to access women-only services across Scotland. Such proposals would potentially open the door for violent males who identify as men to abuse the process. Failure to provide single-sex spaces to female survivors of male violence leads to self-exclusion from support and refuge services. She then says, "While I commend the government for listening to the voices of trans women, including organisations that represent them, I am concerned that the consultations for this proposal do not appear to have been sufficiently inclusive of other groups of women, most notably female victims of violence. It has been reported that 5 survivors of male violence approached the Scottish Parliament's Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee to speak in a private session about their concerns in relation to the bill and their own experiences of self-exclusion. The convener reportedly informed the group that the committee did not have the time to see them and put their objections in writing. If this government truly wants to help victims, it needs to listen to all parties. When introducing new bills, it needs to listen to all points of view. And when members of their own party raise concerns with them, they need to listen. Otherwise, we will bring in bad law with untold, unintended consequences." Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Katie Clark, to be followed by Alexander Stewart for around 4 minutes, Ms Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate Pam Gosol on securing this debate and all who have contributed in this debate, which is to recognise and bring focus to the International Day, which takes place on Friday, for the elimination of violence against women and girls, and to the 16 days of activism following Friday, which run until 10th of December, Human Rights Day. As has been said a number of times in this debate, the World Health Organization estimate that just under 1 in 3 women globally are subjected to partner violence. I think perhaps what's more shocking is that that's the similar statistic that exists in Scotland. 1 in 3 women and girls in Scotland also experience the threat and the reality of physical violence. So those are statistics, but they're about real people and they're about real women, and many of those victims are hidden. And I would like to speak about one of those women who's already been referred to by Beatrice Wishaw, Adrienne McCartney, whose experience was recounted in an article in the Sunday Post by Marion Scott on the 3rd of October 2021. And Adrienne McCartney on that occasion spoke in her own words about a series of failures by the police and the prosecution service that she said had shattered her trust in Scotland's justice system. She described an ongoing campaign of abuse and harassment from her estranged husband. And she claimed that officers had dismissed her fears for her family's safety. Eventually, her husband was charged and the Crown Office apologised for errors, and her husband received a £450 fine. More shockingly, however, Adrienne is no longer with us. She was found dead as a result of taking prescription drugs that she had been prescribed initially, powerful painkillers which she was taking as a result of injuries to her arm, which had been injured by her husband in a violent outburst, and alcohol. And her family are of the very clear view that her death was a direct result of her treatment by the police and prosecution services. Unfortunately, Adrienne is only one of many women who recount similar experiences. And I think this Parliament and members of this Parliament have to reflect on the fact that despite all of these debates, we continue to fail women and girls in Scotland. Last week, an inquest in England found that the police had made errors which had contributed to the death of Naeem Udeh, aged 22, and her mother, Keola Salim, aged 49, in Solihull in 2018. And many of us will have heard Naeem Udeh's call to the police asking for help, as it was widely circulated in the media. I congratulate everybody that's contributed today, but I think we all have to reflect that despite these debates, the threat that we face is probably getting greater, and both Martin Wishaw and Pauline McNeill have spoken about the experiences of girls and young women, and we need to reflect over the coming period, and particularly during these 16 days of action, what we can do to make sure that we truly take the action required to eliminate violence against women and girls in this country and indeed worldwide.
Thank you very much, Ms Clark. I now call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy for around 4 minutes, Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I congratulate my colleague Pam Gosnell on securing this member's business debate this evening. Every year we mark the start of 16 days of activism against violence against women and girls, but this year the focus of the campaign will be on Unite to ensure that girls and women are supported. It will also promote the leadership of women and girls to increase their participation in democracy around the world. Initiatives along the lines of Ask Her to Stand campaign have a role to play in this promotion. However, it is clear there is much more that requires to be done to increase the number of women in positions of power. There are many risk factors associated with violence against women, including poverty, isolation, which have been exacerbated during the COVID pandemic. And sadly, women are already reporting significant increases in violence against them in countries around the world. But the sad truth, Presiding Officer, is that Scotland has not been immune from the effects of the pandemic in this regard. For we know that Scotland's domestic abuse charges are at a high. Alarmingly, organisations such as Scotland's Women's Aid and Rape Crisis Scotland have reported huge increase in demand for their frontline services. Funding is crucial, Deputy Presiding Officer, and the need that we have at present when we're going through this cost of living crisis, more and more people will be requiring support. Projects such as Fife Women's Aid and Kingdom Abuse Survivors Project in my own region have received funding in the past, but will require more to maintain and sustain their services. And I look forward to hearing from the Minister giving assurances that these will come forward in the coming months and years. Many of these organisations will tell you the effects of the pandemic are being felt across the sector. We also know that there is a court backlog of thousands of domestic violence cases, of which a high percentage involve allegations of sexual violence. Some victims currently have to wait up to 3 years between reporting their abuse and securing the abuse for coming to court. Scotland's Women's Aid has warned that the risk undergoing and the confidence of women in the justice system, and we cannot have it undermined at all. Women should not be fearful of the length of time it's going to take. And I hope I'm wrong, although I fear I'll be right, unless urgent action is taken to tackle that backlog. But while this issue is a global one, indeed a Scottish one, for me it's a personal one. My mother herself was subjected to violence from my father for many years, and I witnessed that as a young child. She accepted this abuse for years and blamed herself before she had the courage to take her three small children out of the situation before she became a statistic herself. But many women and girls do not have that courage to leave their abusive partner, and much more needs to be done to support them to have the courage to leave an abusive relationship. Presiding Officer, few issues are more deserving of parliamentary time than we are having this evening's debate. It's with regret that this debate itself has to take place at all, but it has to because we need to speak up. We need to make sure that voices are heard, that people sit up and listen. And I pay tribute to Pam Gosnell for the work she's doing on her members' bill, and I hope it continues with the success that it deserves. Only through society acting as a whole can we finally eliminate the violence and ensure that women can live without fear wherever they find themselves. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Stewart. I now call Pam Duncan-Glancy for around 4 minutes. Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you to Pam Gosol for securing this debate. It is a sad reality as we approach International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women 2022 that gendered violence is still widespread. In Scotland, as we've already heard in the Chamber today, one in three women will experience domestic violence in their lifetime, and an average of six rapes are reported a day. Women are often subjected to gendered violence from an early age, with a report from the University of Glasgow revealing that sexual harassment is common in Scotland's secondary schools. This is not only deeply upsetting or even traumatising for young girls, but it can mean that we have generations growing up viewing gender-based violence as somehow normal or inevitable. We cannot allow this to continue. Violence against women is an epidemic. Most women have experienced or know someone who has experienced misogyny, assault or violence at the hands of men. And it is particularly prevalent amongst women from minority groups. Disabled women in the UK are twice as likely to experience gendered violence. 83% of trans women have experienced hate crime. Black minority ethnic and migrant women face higher levels of domestic homicide and abuse-driven suicide. Every one of us, not just us in this chamber, but across our country, has the responsibility to do everything we possibly can to end it. That means challenging misogyny when we see or hear it, rather than looking away, as well as educating ourselves and reflecting on our own internalised views and perspectives. Men in particular have a responsibility to do and be better. The behaviour and attitudes of men must improve to end the violence. This is, of course, not to say that all men are violent towards women, but we need male allies to fight this battle with us. It also means tackling relentlessly the inequalities in income, power and wealth that drive misogyny too. There are countless incredible organisations across Scotland working tirelessly to end gendered violence and support the victims of it. And I want to give thanks to them today, especially in the Glasgow region, such as Glasgow Women's Aid, the Daisy Project, Glasgow and Clyde Rape Crisis, Wise Women and more, for all the invaluable work that you do. However, this vital work, is impacted by short-term funding arrangements, with the funding received by many of these organisations due to end by September 2023. This means they are in a constant cycle of applying for, receiving and then reapplying for funding, whilst operating with standstill or reduced funding from the government or local authority. Not only does this mean that too much of this organisation's time is consumed with worrying about it, it is distracting from service provision and it's costly. Violence against women and girls costs over £1.8 billion a year in harm that it causes in Glasgow. The cost to the public services and the cost to the wider economy through loss of output. However, the Standing Group on Violence Against Women in Glasgow estimate that properly funding women's services would save £6.5 million to the public purse each year. The Scottish Government has the power and responsibility to ensure these organisations are funded properly, and I hope it will do so. The Scottish Government and we as a Parliament also have responsibility and authority to act through the creation of legislation to protect women and girls and enshrine their rights in law. And I support the recommendations of the Baroness Kennedy report. I welcome the Government's commitment to holding a public consultation prior to introducing a bill to Parliament, which could include, hopefully, among other things, a new statutory aggravation of misogyny. However, the law alone cannot end violence against women. Much more must be done to challenge the misogyny that has come ingrained in society and institutions. I also therefore support calls in Baroness Kennedy's report for the government to invest sufficient resources in training across the criminal justice system and in frontline agencies like schools and colleges to improve technology and police capacity for recording and reporting and in measures to help men and boys understand misogyny. Every one of us has a responsibility to do everything in our power to end violence against women and girls. Let us use this International Day for the elimination of violence against women and the 16 days of activism against gender-based violence to redouble our efforts and work to eliminate gender-based violence and inequality once and for all. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Clancy. I now call on Christina McKelvey to respond to the debate. Minister, for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And may I thank Pam Gosol for bringing the motion recognising the International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women and the vital role that men must play in challenging and eradicating violence against women and girls. And can I start by picking up on a point, Presiding Officer, that both Beatrice Wishart and Katie Clark spoke about, and it's to convey the Scottish Government's condolences to the family of Adrian McCartney. As I say, we give our condolences to that family, to Adrian, but also it just gives us the reason why we're all here today again. At the outset of this debate, we hear about another woman who's died at the hands of a man. Presiding officer, I would also want to pay tribute to the women and girls in Iran and Afghanistan, like Pam Gozo, Michelle Thompson and Beatrice Wishart. I think, you know, we look at those women in awe and we send our solidarity and support to them. And I thought I would also like to highlight that next week there will be a further opportunity during the wider Scottish Government debate to reflect on what more we can all do to ensure that gender-based violence is tackled head-on. Presiding officer, Beatrice Wishart and Paula McNeill say the root of violence against women is misogyny, and we've just heard very eloquently from Pam Duncan-Glancy on why we all agree with Baroness Kennedy's report and why that work to bring forward that piece of legislation and those aggravations are incredibly important. But the plain fact is, Presiding Officer, this is not a women's problem. This is a men's problem. So the men have to step up. They must play their role in eradicating this blight in our society. Violence against women and girls has no place in our vision for a safe, strong and successful Scotland. And as White Ribbon Scotland, the campaign to involve men in tackling violence against women, say, while most men are not violent to women, many ignore the problem by simply remaining silent. They unwittingly create a conducive context for violence to continue. This must stop. They must take responsibility. And that's why the initiatives that Martin Whitfield described by White Ribbon Scotland are so welcome and needed. And as I look around the chamber today, I know in my heart that we all acknowledge that men must recognise that violence against women is a violation of women's fundamental human rights. And Maggie Chapman very eloquently gave us many examples in her contribution. The International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women on the 25th of November marks the launch of the 16 Days of Activism. The theme this year is Unite. Over this period, we will come together, unite many times and at many venues across Scotland, including in this Parliament, to recognise the work being undertaken day in and day out to tackle and eradicate violence against women. We will also talk of the challenges and what more we can do and must do individually and collectively to tackle this failing in society. And I know that these are challenging times, like the pandemic and the cost crisis, that make lives of the victim survivors harder and place enormous pressure on the life-saving services on which many rely. So let us take this opportunity to reflect on what we still wish to achieve. Let us do that with openness. Let us do so with respect and with recognition that others look to all of us to meet the challenges head on. But most importantly, let us acknowledge differences of opinion. Not let this be the opportunity for a political point score, but seek common ground. I know that is the spirit in which this debate has been undertaken today. Tackling and eradicating violence against women is a key priority for this government. Championing this issue is something that I will continue to do. It's the thing that I've done since the first day I stepped in this building, and we will continue to deliver those societal changes needed to ensure every woman and girl in Scotland lives free from abuse. I therefore echo the sentiment in today's motion and all the contributions from everyone today that recognises the opportunity to come together with a call for an end to gender-based violence. But I would go further and say this is something we should be doing daily, all of us. So I agree with the Clydebank Women's Aid workers who Mary McNair spoke with. This is not just for the 16 days, it's for every day. And we will do all we can around about funding. We currently have an independent review ongoing right now that looks at that's looking at the landscape for women's services across Scotland to make them more sustainable and to make sure that they've got the strength to carry on. And if you've not seen it yet, please go and look at the six-month report from the Deliver an Equally Safe Fund. You will be inspired, motivated, and hopefully you will see some of the difference that these organisations are making, especially when they take an intersectional approach to their work. And only last week, Presiding Officer, I met with COSLA and other key partners to look again at our Equally Safe strategy and how we can galvanise and collaborate working with key partners. As always, I am more than happy to speak with members about the development of Equally Safe, and I'm also aware of the ideas by many in this Parliament. Today we've heard many this evening of what we need to do to make a difference here, influence policy and influence our approach going forward. Those with lived experience must form the backbone of our policy development. As Carol Morgan says, we must amplify their voices. Equally, I consider the need to look at how young people are embedded within our discussion and are better allowed to play their part in developing solutions to the challenges that we face. So Pam Duncan-Glancy and Polly McNeill spoke of schools, and I hope they will be interested in the work of the Gender Equality Task Force in Education and Learning, which met just today, and I am working with them on that. So please have a look at that. And I would also pay tribute for every opportunity I ever get to pay tribute to Fiona Druitt and Emily Test. Presiding Officer, my door is and will continue to be open to listen to any initiatives that further the collective aspiration, just as I am prepared to respond to constructive criticism around what we could be doing better. So I await the details of Pam Gosel's proposal with interest. She knows this. We have discussed it before. But in conclusion, Presiding Officer, this evening's debate has highlighted yet again what this Parliament does so well, the ability of members on all sides of the chamber to come together in solidarity and with a renewed commitment to tackle violence against women and girls. I acknowledge the appetite for further action to tackle the root causes. I renew my offer to listen to any views and ideas about how that might be achieved. Many have been articulated tonight. What is important is that we all leave here with that goal clearly in mind, and that is we as politicians work together and lead by examples. Like many speakers, I would also take the time to pay tribute to the frontline organisations, the survivors and campaigners of violence against women and girls, both here and globally. As we approach the 16 days of activism, we rightly recognise the 16 days of activism, that this is a daily fight that we must win. So in the spirit of the women and girls in Iran, unite in their cry, women, life, freedom. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.